There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide. For all the love I've ever felt comes like a flood.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the day. It's a great day to be in the house of the Lord tonight. Why don't we go ahead? Why don't we open up in prayer? Heavenly Father, we come to you, and Lord, what a gift it is to come to your house to serve you.
Sadness from where you've been. Come broken hearted, let it rest.
We could see who we're made to be beyond the fear and doubt that feels so crippling. Song would rise today of a king's glory, who rules the universe and calls us all by name. Oh, we are set apart. Oh, we are who we are. We are the king. Set a fire we cannot hide, and we such a time as this, not to gain the world but make a difference. Oh, we are set apart. Oh, this is where we start. We are the kingdom. We are the light. You set.
Your voice and lay your In Deuteronomy 23:14, it says, "For the Lord your God moves about in your camp to protect you and deliver your enemies to you." God is on the move.
Anytime a heart turns from darkness to light, anytime temptation comes and someone stands to fight, anytime somebody lives to serve and not be served, I know
God is on the move, on the move. Hallelujah. God is on the move in many mighty ways. God is on the move, on the move. Hallelujah. God is on the move, on the move today.
Time in weakness, someone falls upon their knees, or dares to speak the truth that sets men free. Anytime the choice is made to stand upon the word, I know.
God is on the move, on the move. Hallelujah. God is on the move in many mighty ways. God is on the move, on the move. Hallelujah. God is on the move.
On the move today. I see a generation standing on the truth. In each and every nation, God's on the move. Anytime the gospel stirs the love for searching souls, and someone says, "Send me," here I go. I know.
God is on the move, on the move. Hallelujah. God is on the move in many mighty ways. God is on the move, on the move. Hallelujah. God is on the move today. God is on the move, on the move. Hallelujah. God is on the move. God is on the move, on the move. Hallelujah. God is on the move, on the move today. I see a generation standing on the truth. In each and every nation, God is on the move.
John 4:14 says, "But those who drink the water I give will never be thirsty again. It becomes a fresh, bubbling spring within them, giving them eternal life."
We'll try, but it can never fill.
Before we start, I wanted to just let you all know, I like to bring the Bible to life. I like to make it real. And in order to do that, sometimes we have to plaster it right in front of your face. So why don't we begin?
Look at her over there. Always has her nose in the Bible.
Yeah, she takes this Jesus thing way too far.
She's always so full of joy. How does she do that even when things are tough?
I have no clue, but I believe in God, but jeez.
Yeah, I'm with you. I mean, I believe in God and everything. It's not my top priority. I have kids, I got work. I mean, what about my time?
Hey guys, how's it going?
Oh.
Here we go again.
I know, it's that Jesus freak, right?
Well.
Okay, I know that you guys believe in God, but have you ever asked yourself why? And what do you actually believe in?
Actually, no.
Me neither.
Well, let me tell you a little story, because you guys aren't the only one. Why don't you go have a seat? Now, tonight's scripture, a lot of you may know, is the Samaritan woman at the well. And you might be wondering, how does that skit fit into the Samaritan woman in a well? Well, let's start out by reading it. We can find the story in John 4. And I'm going to read out of the NLT version. And I'm going to start at 4:4, so if anyone wants to join me. He had to go through Samaria on the way. Eventually, he came to the Samaritan village of Sychar, near the field that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired from his long walk, sat wearily beside the well about noontime. Soon, a Samaritan woman came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Please give me a drink." He was alone at the time because his disciples had gone into the village to buy some food. The woman was surprised, for Jews refused to have anything to do with Samaritans. She said to Jesus, "You are a Jew, and I am a Samaritan woman. Why are you asking me for a drink?" Jesus replied, "If only you knew the gift God had to give to you, and who you are speaking to, you would ask me, and I would give you living water." "But sir, you don't have a rope or a bucket," she said, "and this well is very deep. Where would you get this living water? And besides, do you think you're greater than our ancestor Jacob, who gave us this well? How can you offer better water than he and his sons and his animals enjoyed?" Jesus replied, "Anyone who drinks this water will soon become thirsty again. But those who drink the water I give will never be thirsty again. It becomes a fresh, bubbling spring within them, giving them eternal life." "Please, sir," the woman said, "give me this water. Then I'll never be thirsty again, and I won't have to come here to get water." "Go and get your husband," Jesus told her. "I don't have a husband," the woman replied. Jesus said, "You're right. You don't have a husband, for you have had five husbands, and you aren't even married to the man you're living with now. You certainly spoke the truth." "Sir," said the woman, "you must be a prophet. So tell me, why is it that you Jews insist that Jerusalem is the only place of worship, while we Samaritans claim it is here at Mount Gerizim, where our ancestors worshiped?" Jesus replied, "Believe me, dear woman, the time is coming when it will no longer matter whether you worship the Father on this mountain or in Jerusalem. You Samaritans know very little about the one you worship, while we Jews know all about him, for salvation comes through the Jews. But the time is coming, indeed it's here now, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. The Father is looking for those who will worship him that way. For God is spirit, so those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth." The woman said, "I know the Messiah is coming, the one who is called Christ. When he comes, he will explain everything to us." Then Jesus told her, "I am the Messiah." This has always been one of my very, very favorite stories, mainly because at one time I was that woman at the well. So why don't we wait? Why don't we break this down just a little bit? First of all, this can be made into a number of studies, but I just want to touch upon some key points this evening. So we have to, when we look at it, we can find that it's actually one of the longest one-on-one conversations that Jesus had with anyone in Scripture. Then we notice that it says that it was noon when Jesus went to the well and the Samaritan woman was there. But you have to ask, well, why was it, what does that mean? Well, noon is the hottest time of day, and all the other women went there in the mornings and in evenings. She went there because she was the type of woman that, she did some bad stuff, and she was shunned. And a lot of the other women, disgraced her. So she felt that she wasn't good enough, of course. And to save heartache and embarrassment, she went at a time when no one else would be there. Well, what she thought no one else would be there. Then Jesus asked the woman for a drink. And by Jewish law, Jesus broke three traditions. First of all, she was a Samaritan woman. And back in that time, Samaritans were, despised by the Jews. Second was that he had asked her for a drink, meaning that it would be actually ceremonially unclean to drink from her cup or jar, whatever it was that she was using. And the third was rabbis had no business speaking to some shady lady such as her. Okay, the thing is, when Jesus asked her for a drink, the Samaritan woman was going by the law, where Jesus was going by grace. And I think that's very, very important to point out, because he wasn't looking at the law. Then she was talking about the living water. You know, how can you offer me living water? There was very little water at that time in that specific location. So when she was talking about living water and dead water, there was a huge difference between the two. Living water was from like a stream or a creek, something that was actually flowing through throughout the land. Dead water was standing water. It was still. So the water in the well was actually considered dead water by their standards. And what Jesus was, he was so bold that he had said in John 4:13, whoever drinks the water I give him will never thirst. How is that possible? You know, so often in life, we have to make a choice. So in that one sentence, Jesus, he shifted from everyday life to eternal life, which is huge. Now, the woman was unsure if she wanted to take that leap of faith. And honestly, who can blame her? The man's offering her water that she will never thirst again. So, with her being so skeptical, it kind of reminds me how that we are so eager to satisfy our physical desires, but we actually tend to forget about our spiritual needs. And I think, you know, we really need to concentrate more on the spiritual aspect of life than we do any physical need, for sure. Okay, I keep saying I'm sorry. So, okay, there we go again. Jesus, nerves. Jesus asked her to go get her husband in John 4:16. However, Jesus' request wasn't about following society's rules. It was actually uncovering the truth. And she realized that Jesus, at that point, was some sort of prophet because he had said, you know, you are right. You know, you don't have a husband. In fact, you've had five husbands. And you're not even married to the guy that you're living with right now. So she realized, like I said, that he was a prophet. And she asked him about where was the correct place for her to worship God. And Jesus states in 4:22, you Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know. And honestly, that got me to thinking, and if anyone knows me, I'm an extremely deep thinker, and I dig deep into everything that God puts inside that little brain of mine. So I asked myself, well, what about, how does that apply to us here today? And, you know, if you look at the skit that you just witnessed, how many people claim to be a Christian? Now, it's said that there's about 70 to 75% of Americans, United States Americans, believe in God. And that's great. But I have to wonder, do they actually know who Jesus Christ is? And I've asked myself these exact same questions over and over and over. I'm digging deep. I'm making sure that, you know, I'm following his way. So, there that so is again. Relationships are important in life, are they not? To have no contact with others would be quite lonely. And quite honestly, Jesus wants that relationship with us too. And, however, this is the awesome thing about God. God loves us so much that he has given us the freedom of choice. He gives us that free will. He wants us to love him with all of our hearts and all of our minds and everything that we have. That's what he wants from us. Does he always get that? Absolutely not. And it's a daily decision to do that. As I said, Jesus wants that relationship with us too. And for Jesus, it's honestly not about religion. He doesn't care if you're Baptist or if you're Methodist or Catholic or whatever, that it has no bearings to him. So we have to ask ourselves, what is this life for then? The way I can come up with it is to become exactly who God wants us to be. For us to seek him with all of our hearts so that we can do his will and surrender our will. Because our will isn't always the best. You know, we all make mistakes. We all tend to fall short each and every single day of our lives. So I believe that that's what God wants us, is he wants us to surrender ourselves and have that personal relationship with him. To him, that I believe that's what matters most. Jesus is the source of light while we are the reflection. And I saw this quote and I absolutely fell in love with it. It says, Jesus is the source of light while we are the reflection, a mirror. Jesus is the word while we are the voice. No, we are his hands, we are his feet, we are his voice, we are everything projecting out into this really dark world. And it's scary. And we have to ask ourselves, you know, how do we get out there? Well, the more that you have a personal relationship with him, the more you're going to want to follow his will, the more you love him, the more that you're going to try and do whatever it is that he calls you to do. And I'll be honest with you, and I said this last Friday, 9th grade, I was in social studies class, and they wanted me to recite the Gettysburg Address in the middle of the class, up front. Well, you know what I did? No. That was actually one of the reasons why I failed 9th grade, because I refused to get up in the front of the class and recite that. You know, and then all of a sudden, a couple years ago, God calls me and he says, this is what I want you to do. I want you to get up in front of these people and I want you to tell your story. No, how can I do that? There's no way possible. Yes, you're going to, and I'm going to help you. It was at that point. We're going to put that over there. It was at that point that I realized what I needed to do. I needed to go to that well. I needed to take that drink of living water. You know, like I said, I believed in God for so many years. I had faith. But to be honest with you, I didn't know an awful lot. You know, up on that screen there, there's so many things that describe Jesus. He's the Redeemer. He is the Lamb of God. He's light. He's the Word. He's love. He's a servant. He's the King of Kings. But did I actually know any of that? Nope. It was a dark time to realize what I was missing in this life. That I wasn't ready, I don't know, that I was just being stubborn, because Lord knows I'm so stubborn. But I pushed him away. I heard him knocking before. But I kept pushing away. No, not now. We're just hold on. You know, let me finish doing this first. Well, I'm not good enough. I'm just this broken spirit that just isn't worth it. You know, honestly, I didn't even know if God ever thought of me. Why would he think of someone like me? How many times did I cry out to him and I heard nothing but silence? So this opportunity came and he made me do it. And when I tell you he made me do it, I'm telling you he made me do this. When my fingers typed the question, that I didn't type that question. And whenever I was asked if I wanted to speak, I'm like, no. No, absolutely not. No, no. Mm-mm. You can't make me. And next thing I know, I'm typing yes. when I was trying to type no, I was searching for that N and I could not find it. So I go and I get in front of this audience of about 100, and I'm so nervous, just like I am tonight. And the butterflies are going. And as I start speaking, the Holy Spirit literally just takes over everything. And He helps me through the entire thing. And I felt such a high, so incredibly blessed. I was soaring through the clouds at that time, knowing that it wasn't necessarily my story, it wasn't necessarily my message, but it touched others, and I did it because God wanted me to, not because I wanted to. Trust me, there was no way. It was up to me. There was no way. And when you do that, you get this sense of, oh my gosh, pure elation. I can't even explain it to you. And after that night, I said, okay, all right, Lord, I gotcha. I know where you're going with this. And I said, I give everything from that's inside of me, my outside, whatever, all of it, I'm going to give it to you. I made a conscious decision to turn my life over to Christ in every single aspect. And honestly, I believe that that's what He wants everyone to do. Every person in here, out there, it doesn't matter where you are. God wants you because you're worth it and you are loved. And He's got this huge plan. And we are all inside that plan. It doesn't matter if you're taking stuff out to the homeless. Doesn't matter if you're up here. Doesn't matter if you're even gone to school and you're a teacher. No matter where you're at, no matter what job you're doing, it doesn't matter. You have a purpose. And to be able to accept that, willingly accept that, and take it out to the world and proclaim Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. That's what it's all about. To have a love so immeasurable that you're literally bursting at the seams because of the love that you feel inside of you. That's power. That's God, and that's Him working inside of you. And He wants you to take that out into the world. Proclaim it. It would be so amazing if more and more people would surrender themselves to Jesus Christ. And just like that woman at the well, I think of her. And she was tainted, just like everyone else is. And yet Jesus still went out and reached out to her. And He's telling her, look, I have this gift for you. If only you take it. And she gets scared. Well, wait a second. We're going to ask 1,000 questions, do we not? Well, wait, no, this isn't right. I don't know if I can do this. How often do you tell God no? How often do you push Him to the side? How often do you look in the mirror and say, man, I just don't like me? Jesus is there waiting for you. And He wants you to accept Him into His heart. Tell Him, Lord, I love you. I said that to a group one day, and I said, do you ever just tell God you love Him? And I got that wild-eyed look like, what? Yeah, just tell me you love Him. Why? Well, because He needs to hear it too. You tell your kids, you tell your husbands, your wives, your different family members and friends. God wants that same thing from you as well. And building that relationship with Him, it just enforces all of that. How do you build a relationship with Him? Prayer. Oh my gosh, lots of prayer. I've spent hours praying, just trying to figure it all out. You know, I was in such a quest for truth, I forgot that I needed to pray. I used to study scripture after scripture after scripture, and I didn't have that personal relationship with him, which was tough because I'm thinking, okay, well, you know, I'm reading all this scripture, but what does it really mean to me? When you open that book, ask God, Lord, help me to understand what it is that you're trying to tell me. Make those words pop up and off that page. And I promise you that happens, because it's happened to me, especially with 2 Samuel 22:2-3. When I read those lines, without a doubt, they literally came jumping off that page. And he'll do the exact same thing for you. So not only do you pray, scripture actually even says to pray without ceasing. It's a constant prayer. When you're constantly, like I always catch myself talking to God. And I think to myself, well, do I have to say an amen? No, I'll just keep going. Because he hears me regardless. So we'll pray. And of course, reading scripture is another way to build that personal relationship with him. How do you know him? Well, the only way to know him is to start reading scripture. It tells you all about who he is, the life that he had led here on earth. And it even tells you before he ever came, leading up to his arrival. And there's so many good lessons within all that context. It comes alive. You know, I said last Friday, actually, I said, you know, I look at the Bible as a love story. And honestly, I got that off of a movie called Joshua, I think. But I look at the Bible as a love story. It's the ultimate act of love, the ultimate sacrifice. So I ask, have you or are you ready to surrender absolutely everything over to Christ? Take that drink of water. I promise you won't thirst anymore. You will have a love so incredible that it makes you want to cry. To realize the sacrifice that he has done for you. He's a personal God. He's not just a God. You know, many people have so many little tiny idols and tiny gods. You know, we've got a big house and we've got a nice car and we've got this awesome job. But inside, they are dying and they're hurting and they're breaking. It's a broken world. And just like that song in the well, we try to fill the world. We try to fill our life with what the contents of the world is. And honestly, that will never, ever work. Because you will continue to keep searching and pulling stuff out of that world to try to fill this emptiness that's inside. It's not going to work. There's only one thing that can fill you completely, and that's Jesus Christ. Having that personal relationship with him. Reaching out to him in those dark times. You know how I get joy even whenever I'm sad? I look to him. Because I know that he loves me regardless. And I know that he will help me carry that load. And he says his yoke is what's the word, easy? Light, thank you. His yoke is light. And that's true. I can be at the lowest of lows and I still have a joy because it comes from him and a really good mentor. So if you haven't already, I pray for each and every single one of you to hand your life over. Go to the well. Take that drink. Realize that he's a personal and loving Savior and he wants you. He needs you. Because he's got a purpose for you and he's got a will for you. Father, we thank you for this evening. Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you for your message. And be with each and every single person as they leave here tonight. Just bless them and just let them feel your presence within their life. And allow us to go out and proclaim your name as Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.